Park de l'Amour, okay, or the Love Park. And there were a group of artists led by a sculpture artist named Victor Delphine, okay? The whole park is dedicated to love. The main thing, this is meant to be Victor Delphine and his wife. It's called El Beso, or the kiss. And I always feel like we're interrupting something, but we, you know, have to take our photo there. And they also, throughout the park, you see it's sort of a Gaudi style. If any of you have been to Barcelona, they've done mosaics, and all of these are quotes from Spanish literature and song, etc., having to do with love. Okay, after we have our walk in the park, we go to see the more traditional sites in Lima, and we go to the main square. Here is the changing of the guard, and I want to show you a video of the changing of the guard. Right? Why isn't this working? Hold on. Okay, hold on. Hope you can see this and hear this. So here is a little bit of the changing of the guard. This is in front of the president's house. Wait. Okay. Whoops. Okay. So here we're still in the main square. Okay. Here is the main fountain in the square there. Okay. Where the fountain is today. The fountain is there since the 17th century, but that was actually originally where there was a gallows, and that's where they would have public hangings and executions. We're in the main square, like in many places. That's the left picture. The right picture, it's very interesting. The sign says that it's Jewish Street, okay? Calle de los Judios, okay? Jewish Street. It wasn't a Jewish neighborhood. Why is it Jewish Street? This street, which is actually on the corner, facing the square, facing actually the back of the cathedral, was where they led. I talked about the Inquisition before, where they would lead the Jews to their executions in the times of the Inquisition, which lasted till 1820. Okay, they would start from there. Also, why it was facing the cathedral, on the wall of the cathedral, they would list the names of all of the Jews who were accused and all of those who were going to be executed. So it was facing that street. And to this day, it's called that. Okay? So this is before I tell you about the Larco Museum, the tours used to go to the Inquisition Museum, which was a fascinating place, but it has been closed, they say, for renovations for the past few years. I have a few ideas that it's not for renovations, that they're trying to sort of rewrite history or erase history. The museum hasn't been open for a few years. So we started to look for different options. Where could we go instead? So there's an amazing museum called the Larco Museum. It's actually located in a viceroy's mansion. What was the Larco Museum? There was a 20th century historian, a Peruvian historian named Rafael Larco, and he has a collection of ancient artifacts, mainly from the cultures that predated the Inca, and mainly from a culture called the Moshe or the Moshika, okay, who are actually famous for, as you can see in the right picture here, for what's called the portrait vessels. Before I said, we don't know that much about these civilizations because they didn't have a written language, but we learn a lot from the different artifacts that were found. The Moshe civilization dates back all the way to 200 BCE, okay, and till around zero, okay, or one, whatever. Okay, so we can see here how clear the features are, what people look like at that time. And on the left here is the kipu that I alluded to before, which was what I talked about. This was the way that the Incas passed down information, whether it was calculations, whether it was censuses, whether it was historical information. But people today, there are researchers trying to analyze the kipu, but they're finding it very difficult. Okay. On the third day of our tour, we go to the Gold Museum. Okay, just a little bit about the Gold Museum. The collector also, it was a collection of one man. His name was Miguel Mujico Gallo, okay? He was a businessman, a diplomat, and a politician, and he collected over 7,000 items, mainly gold, also weapons, also different artifacts, whether it's clothing, but I'm gonna focus more on the gold, okay? Most of the gold items come from the what was known as the Lambayek civilization, that they were approximately from 750 CE to 1375, right before the Incas, because it ended a little bit before the Incas. So the Inca, it's actually a little bit of overlap because the Incas began small at the end of the 12th century, but they really took over and became an empire in 1438. So what are we looking here at? Some of you may have heard of a tumi, okay? A lot of people think the picture on the left is the tumi. And I'm gonna explain to you what a tumi is. Okay, they think it's that sort of, that guy, that figure there. But the tumi is actually the bottom part. What we're seeing here on the right, we're seeing many tumis here, which was actually a knife. This was a knife, this was a blade that was used for circumcision, for operations, and for both medical and also ritual proceedings. The figure on the top is actually his name, he has a name, is Nailamp, and he was the first, this is supposed to look like the first emperor of the Lambayek people. Okay, so where people will often refer to him as the tumi, but the tumi is actually the bottom part, which is the knife. And what's interesting, what I wanted to show you here, is to this day, the Medical Association of Peru uses the symbol of the tumi, that bottom part, that knife, as the symbol for the Medical Association. That is their symbol. That shows medicine, because that was the earliest known medical tool that they have found. Okay, just more gold. Also, these are all Lambayek vessels. Here we see portrait. Before we saw the portrait vessels of the Moshe or the Moshika in ceramics. Here we see portrait vessels in gold. We see masks. Okay, so these are the different articles that when we go through the museum, we learn about these different civilizations and what all these articles were. What's interesting is this collection, there's a few interesting things about this collection. One is that in 2002, they discovered that maybe a lot of the items are not really gold. And then they sort of disproved that, not sure exactly what the story is there. They did it, what happened there. But this collection also had traveled around the world and it had actually come to Israel in the 1970s. The parts of the collection has traveled around the world. another interesting thing that they used to do brain operations and then fill the skull or the fill the head, the cavity with gold. Now, they think because of the heaviness, well, two things, the heaviness of the gold and also the heat that you need to form the gold needs to reach to be able to form it, to fit to fill the skull, they think that this these must have been post-mortem operations, and it could there was no way that anyone could survive. But here are skulls that have gold in them from skull surgery, dating back to the times of the ancient populations. Okay, and this we're still on day three. So day three, we're still in Lima in the morning, but then we start to make our way down. We start to go south along the coast to where actually we want to get to Paracas. Paracas are actually, it's where there are islands that are known as the Ballestas Islands, which are known as the Galapagos of Peru. But on our way down, we actually took the group for the first time. I always like people tours, they can tell you, I always like to try new things. We took them to a place called La Centinela, which actually is a relatively newly discovered ancient archaeological site, okay, so oxymoron, but of another people that lived in that region that were called the Chincha people. They were farmers, fishermen, artisans, merchants, and what did their trade? They traded copper and coca for emeralds and a special shell called a muyu that was used for making beads, also for jewelry and also for ritual purposes. Coca, as you may know, the coca leaf, which is legal in Peru, while we're there, we drink the coca tea, which is actually very good for altitude sickness. Coke, it's the same leaf that they extract cocaine from, but they in Peru, and I can tell you from drinking coca tea, you don't feel any drug influences. It takes a lot of processes to get the cocaine out of the coca leaf, and it's not, when you have the coca tea, it's not cocaine. But they traded coca, it was and copper for emeralds and shells. Okay, so then we go on a boat ride in Paracas, of the Ballestas Islands, or the Galapagos of Peru. Okay, go on a boat ride to see it's mainly bird life and sea life that we see there. Okay, you see here the cute seal, and here are the birds. Now the birds are very significant. I don't know if any of you have heard of guano, but guano was actually the natural fertilizer made mainly from bird poop. And it used to be actually the British are involved here. The British were on the side of Chile, but there was actually a war in the 1870s between Chile and against Peru, and Bolivia came together because it was all over guano. Predating that war, Bolivia actually went out to the coast. But today Bolivia is all landlocked, and Chile won the war, and they conquered that parts of Bolivia and parts of Peru. And the whole idea was for them to have as much of the coast as possible, because these coastal birds and the guano, would trade for gold. The guano was worth so much money, it was considered the best fertilizer in the world. I wanna show you a video of this cute little seal jumping into the water. Hold on a sec. So just watch the seal, he's here, he's gonna jump in the water. Right. Why is it stuck? Hold on a sec. Okay. All right. So we went Thursday night to Paracas. Friday morning, we did the cruise Friday, we drive back. It's around a 4-hour drive back to Lima. And we spend Shabbat in Lima with the Jewish community. Obviously, I can't show you pictures from Shabbat, but we have a wonderful Shabbat there where they feed us. Oh my God. Okay. They know how to eat in Lima. So whether we have our Friday night dinner, the shul gives a kiddush. You've never seen anything like this, a milchik's par of kiddush. We then have lunch. We then have Suda Shlishit. And Motei Shabbat, we need to walk it off. So where do we go to walk it off? We go to what's known as the Magic Water Circuit Park, or it's known as the Reserve Park. It was a park that was dedicated to all the soldiers in the reserves of Peru. And it was noted in the Guinness Book of World Records, this park, as the largest water fountain park in the world. There are, I remember correctly, 13 fountains. I may be counting wrong. And you walk through and they're all have lights and music and everything. And it culminates with a show at the end. Here are some of our pictures. And again, I want to show you, this is just a short clip from the final show that we see at the end. I think the show lasts like 20 minutes and it's amazing. This is just part of it. So that we were in the Lima area for quite a long time, but then it's time to leave the Lima area. So we get on a plane on Sunday morning and we fly to Cusco. And before there was a question about the elevation. So from Lima to Cusco, it's quite a change. But what we do in order to help the adjustment, we actually leave Cusco very quickly and go down to the Urubamba Valley. And the Urubamba Valley is also where Machu Picchu is located, which will be the next part of our tour. And so when we get to Cusco, we're at 3,800, but we drop down meters. We drop down to around 2,800 meters when we go down to the Urubamba Valley. So we travel, we make our travels so people don't have a hard time adjusting. Basically, if you are under 3,000 meters, that's what the doctors say, and this is what experience, most people will not have a hard time, will not have elevation sickness. From 3,000 meters and above, most people also won't have a hard time and have elevation sickness, but the chances are higher. So in order to let our bodies adjust, we go first to the Urubamba Valley, and then we will make our way back. So our first stop in the Urubamba Valley is a llama park, okay, where we learn there that there are not only llamas, there are actually four from the llama family. There are four kinds of animals that we see there. There's the llama, there's the alpaca, there is the guanaco and the vicuña. Not going to go into which is which. Each one has distinguishing features. Basically, wool-wise, the llama is the cheapest and the roughest, then the alpaca, then the guanaco, and the vicuña wool is considered the most expensive in the world and very rare. So here we are at the llama park, and we learn all about how the wool is dyed. Here you see, it's all, they dye the, you see all the different yarn or wool here is being dyed by different plants, all natural. Here are indigo, all natural things. those who've been to Morocco can remember in the tanneries also how things are dyed all by spices and indigo and coal, etc. Same thing, they're all natural. Here you can actually see all the different colors, and these are all dyed naturally. There's no artificial colors used here. We watch them weave. Then we go from the llama park to a market. And what's really amazing about this market, we go on a Sunday. Every Sunday, all the little villages get together. And this is actually a market for locals, not for tourists. And they are selling fruits and vegetables. And what I love about Peru, besides the fact that you can get a big bag of blueberries for the equivalent of 5 shekels, you have all kinds of fruits that you've never seen before. I like to try a fruit and serve it to the group. This is the Pisac market. They also do sell souvenirs. Here you see a guy selling musical instruments. This is also interesting. One of the national foods of Peru is the guinea pig. Okay, sometimes I say, thank God I'm kosher. And you see this cute little house. There's even a little hammock. You know how in trafe restaurants, they have a tank where you choose your lobster? This was actually taken inside of a restaurant. This is where you choose your guinea pig. The day we were there, there was a local band, but you look in these pictures. So I took pictures of the locals, but I can show you that besides us and maybe a handful of others, there were hardly any tourists. It's mainly locals at this market. Okay, so that's the first day. The next day we wake up early and we go to Machu Picchu. And I'm not gonna go into what Machu Picchu is exactly because no one is really quite sure. And I have all sorts of books. Here's a book here that I recommend called Turn Right at Machu Picchu, which was written by a guy named Mark Adams, who actually traces the path and the of Hiram Bingham, who claims to have discovered Machu Picchu. He thought Machu Picchu was a city called Vilcabamba, which was a hidden capital of the Incas. Turns out that he was wrong, that Vilcabamba is somewhere else, in the same area, but not where he discovered it. He was a scholar in Yale in the early 20th century. There's still a lot of mystery about what Machu Picchu is. Was it a royal town? Was it an administrative town for the emperors? Was it a religious center? You find both types of buildings there, but no one knows. And when I say that the Hiram Bingham thought he discovered it, the locals knew, there were many locals who knew it was there or knew of it. And there were also other explorers that turns out were there before him. But we're not going to get into that. That's a different story altogether. But I just want to show you some of what we look. But what's amazing about it is that this city that we're not sure, administrative center, religious center, a bit of both, it remains, the buildings are intact, and you walk through a city that dates back to the time of the Incas, to the 1400s, 1500s, amazing. Okay, another picture here at Machu Picchu, the llamas. Okay, Machu Picchu is actually referring to the mountain, and actually not to the site, but it became be the name of the site. Okay, how do we get back and forth to Machu Picchu? Did any of you see the movie with Steve Martin and John Candy, Planes, Trains, and Automobiles? Well, first we fly to Cusco, and then we have to take our bus to the train station. From the train station, we take a train that's gorgeous, that goes through all the scenery of the Urubamba Valley. And then we have to go on another bus that takes us up to the hill to the site of Machu Picchu. So it's totally worth the schlep, and it's an enjoyable schlep. And I'm going to show you another video that this is actually a spoiler, because I don't usually tell people about this before the tour, there are some surprises on the train, and here is one of them. Free entertainment.
You can put it on video.
Okay, and this is one of my favorite places. And they wanted to cut it out of my tour last time, and I made sure they didn't. Olan Tai Tembo was one of the administrative centers of the Incas. And it's a city that's a lot of it has remained intact. Now you can see here, you see, the rocks here, these were ancient Inca walls. They've built back on top of it. The streets here, you see the rocks that was built by the Incas. You walk through this town, it is just so charming. And there's a lot of ruins around it as well. We always also have, what I didn't mention, is I always am working together with local tour guides. This was our local guide, Yuri, who calls himself an Inca, though he's descendant of both. He's technically a mestizo. Mestizo, he is a descendant of Spanish and Inca, and the local people, but he calls himself an Inca, and that's my guide and friend, Yuri. Okay, we then go to a chichiria. What is a chichiria? Chicha is the corn beer of Peru. And they have chichirias everywhere in the Urubamba, Cusco area. How do you know there's a chichiria? Chichiria is where they make chicha. They have a pink flag, or sometimes just a pink, like supermarket bag, like a pink, you know, like the small, like little plastic shopping bags. They have it on a flag, like on a stick hanging out, and you know that a chichiria can be in someone's house. And then it means you can come and they'll make and serve chicha. Here we went to a more organized one. You can see there's two kinds of chicha. There's the yellow, okay, it's a low alcoholic corn beer. And there's also one made with strawberries, the pink one. It traditionally was used in religious ceremonies to appease the gods in the Inca tradition. It's used also in ancestor worship. They may feed their ancestors a cup of chicha, but it's also, you know, you go out to drink with the friends and you have a cup of chicha. So we go to the chicheria and we try it. You can see, we learn all about the process. You can see they sprout the corn here first, they ferment it. She explains the whole process to us. She in Quechua, and then it's translated to us to English by our local guide. Okay. On our way, as we're making our way through the Urubamba Valley, also one of my favorite sites are the Maras salt pans. These salt pans were actually built by the Incas, and they're still being used today. There is a salty stream that comes through the mountains, and they have a elaborate system that it goes and makes its way through these pans. And when one gets full, they block off with a stone. Now, who owns these pans? Anyone who lives in the area can claim one if it's not being used by someone, can claim it, and they use it and they harvest the salt. Basically, the water comes in, it fills up, and as time goes on, it evaporates. The process takes a few weeks. And then the salt, you know, rises to the top. And we actually were there. We saw people harvesting the salt. Oh, here you can see someone there. They were harvesting salt from the salt pans. These were built by the Incas. Fascinating site. Okay, we then make it back. So we went through the Urubamba Valley. We were at Machu Picchu on our eighth day, which is our second to last day of our tour. We make it back to Cusco. And to me, I took these pictures and I'm sharing them with you because we all live in Israel. There is no Jewish community in Cusco. There never has been one. There's Chabad there because there is a large community of Israeli young backpackers post-army. And there is a whole culture going on there. You can see all the Hebrew. Here, there's a tour company. I guess the picture's not so clear. Here, they're advertising an Israeli restaurant. Here's the hostel, all this Hebrew. Here's another tour company advertising in Hebrew. It's just like amazing how Israelis come and they take over a city. So I took those pictures. Here we are going into Chabad. And the Chabad building was one of the old buildings of Cusco. This is very much the style with the balcony, with the arches, okay? And we have dinner at Chabad. And then in the evening, we go out to a cultural show to learn about the local culture, the history of the culture. It's dancing, singing. Want to just show you. Here they're playing the song El Condor Pasa, which after I play this for you, I'm going to tell you about it. And then we're going to hear the Simon and Garfunkel version. And we're going to have a sing-along, not with this one, with the Simon and Garfunkel version, but then I'm going to sing in my off-key voice to you. I apologize. While you all are on mute singing to yourselves, because otherwise I was told it will be a complete cacophony because we're not all coordinated. Right. So here is. Before we get to our sing-along, just a few more pictures from our last day. We do a walking tour of Cusco. Here we are by the statue of Pachacutec in the main square of Cusco. Here below, you can see the typical buildings. Just want to talk about these blue balconies. That was the color that originated in the time of the Spanish. You know, a lot of people, when they came from Spain to Peru, or in South America in general, but in Peru, they were the nouveau riche. And blue was a sign. If you painted your balcony blue in your window, so the blue color symbolized the sapphire. It symbolized that you were wealthy. So the nouveau riche would paint it. Today, it's just the style of Cusco, and you see it everywhere. But that was originally the origin of that. Okay. Forgot about these slides. Before I was talking about, at the beginning, I talked about the Inca and how they built and how they would fit the stones together. And what's amazing is they didn't seem to have like a set pattern. It was like a puzzle that they, as they were doing it, they would fit them together. What I'm pointing out here, and unfortunately I don't have a video of myself, but I'm gonna show you a video of my colleague that he kindly shared with me. This is a 12-sided stone. This is the real Inca wall that still exists, still there in the streets of Cusco. 12-sided stone, and that all the rocks, all the other stones fit into it. Here I am having a cup of coffee at the main square, and now I'm gonna show you the video of my colleague, Shimon Attar, showing us exactly how it has 12 sides. Wait a sec.
Nine, shalosh, arba, חמש, שש, שבע, שמונה, תשע, עד כאן, עשר, אחת עשרה, שתים עשרה, נכון?
Okay, so now I'd like to tell you the story behind Simon and Garfunkel made the Peruvian song El Condor Pasa famous. But this is not as the story goes. This is actually a true story that Paul Simon was in France in the 1960s, and he went to a concert of a Peruvian band called Los Incas. And they were playing this amazing instrumental tune that Paul Simon assumed was a folk song, you know, that has no author, no copyright, passed down through the generations. He then took that tune and he wrote the lyrics to the song that we all know, or that I think we all know. But turns out that it wasn't a folk tune. The song El Condor Pasa was actually from an operetta, or they know it, call it a zarzuela, that was composed in 1913 by a composer named Alomia Robles, and it was first performed in 1933. But what happened when Paul Simon came out with the song, or when Simon and Garfunkel came out with the song? Robles's, the original author's, the original composer's son was still alive, and he sued Paul Simon, and he actually won. Paul Simon plays it down, and to this day, he will refer to the song as, officially out there, he refers to it as a traditional Peruvian song. They did change the album covers, giving credit to Robles. But I think to this day, the Robles family are very thankful to Paul Simon for stealing the song, because not only did they win the lawsuit, which got them, you know, some money, but he made the song more famous than it would ever have become if it would have stayed just in Peru. So I think now we will end our presentation with I'll call it a silent sing-along. Right, hold on a sec. Oops, wait, hold on. You know what? Seems like the video is not working. So we will wait. You know what? I'm gonna go out of this, stop share. I'm gonna share a YouTube video. Would we like to have a sing-along? Shake your heads. Or if you're, okay, so hold on a second. How do I get out of full screen? I will go to it on YouTube and share it directly from YouTube. For some reason, it's not working. I'm assuming that you all can hear this and see this.
Oh,
think we can, let me unshare, stop share, see you all. I'm sorry it was so long. I see a few people left and I understand. Okay, I hope you guys enjoyed.
No, that's fine. That was great. Oh, look, applause.
Thank you.
First of all, we do have a few questions.
So okay.
One of the questions is, how, this is from Karen. How difficult or easy is it to get up to Machu Picchu for someone who has slight mobility problems?
Okay, that's a very good question. And I'm going to answer that everyone can go up to Machu Picchu and I will explain. As I told you about our trains, planes, and automobiles, when we arrive to Machu Picchu after taking the train and taking the bus, we arrive to the main area, we go into the main entrance, and basically you can see everything from there, okay? You don't have to climb anything, you can see everything. We then give the group, say we, me, and the local guide, an explanation of where we are, what we're looking at, and those who cannot make a climb stay down below. They have two options. People who have, if they have serious mobility issues, can just wait. There's a nice coffee shop there after they've had a nice view. Or you can walk around all the buildings in the lower part. What we do is we make a climb that's not that difficult, but it's not everyone could do it. My group, my last group, almost everyone went, even an 80-year-old. Only four people didn't go up. An 86-year-old, an 82-year-old, and a 60-something-year-old with back problems and his wife. But everyone else went up to the top. It's a 20-minute walk up. I won't say it's easy, but it's not that bad. There are definitely, one of the women in my group said that she had done Nahal Jilabon in the Golan. I don't know if any of you know the Tiul. The week before, a 78-year-old woman said this was easier. Machu Picchu, where do we go to? We do that 20-minute climb, and from there are those iconic pictures where that you saw of the mountains and of everything below. We then from there, we walk down. It's a nice path walking down, which is very easy, and then we walk through the buildings and explore. So if you have mobility issues, you can come on the tour, and you may not make that 20-minute walk up to the top. You may just stay below and walk through the buildings, but everyone can see Machu Picchu. You will definitely will see stuff. You just won't see it from the perspective of above. Does that answer your question, Karen, wherever you are?
I think so. Okay, now Val has a question. Val wants to know, how much Spanish influence is there in Peru?
Very much. Okay, first of all, The main language today is Spanish. What I said is there's a revival now of the Inca culture, but that you'll see more in the highlands, okay? In Lima, you will feel it's very Spanish. The main official language is Spanish, okay? Which is like 85%, I think. I don't remember now my numbers, but the majority, that is the main official language, the culture, the religion. You know, most people, the majority of the population is still Catholic. The Spanish culture took over. You have to realize the Spanish were ruling there. It only became an independent country nearly 300 years after the Spanish came. The Spanish came in 1532, and only in 1821 they got independence, and only in 1824 really full independence. So Spanish is the language spoken, and the culture is very Spanish influenced, you know, but with that wonderful flavor of the Incas and the other pre-Columbian population. Does that answer the question?
Val, you answer the question? Val? Yes.
Okay, what I do want to say, what's interesting, and I have a couple of phrase books that I'm not a Spanish speaker, not in any way possible, but the Spanish in South America or in Latin America in general is different than the Spanish spoken in Spain. Well, just like you guys can understand me, but not maybe every word, because my American English is different than your British English. I'm joking, but there are words that are different. One, for example, is the word for potatoes. Right now I'm forgetting which one, but I think in Spain it's patatas, and then in one of the countries it's papas, and when it's in patatas. There are words that are different. There are things when you're learning the language, like my daughter now, one of my daughters is studying Spanish, but when I gave her my books, I said, this is not Spanish for Spain, this is Spanish for South America. It's a slightly, you know, different dialect, which makes sense.
Okay, thank you. Okay, yes, there's a question for Stephen. Now, Stephen says, years ago, he read books, The Chariots of the Gods by von Daniken, who suggested that the Incas had made huge drawings in the chalky ground that could be seen from space at Nazca.
Okay, so I'm going to correct. The drawings, and I didn't talk about them, they were not made by the Incas. They were actually made by the Nazca people, who predated the Incas. There's different civilizations that are called Nazca lines. One of the things we see when we go to Paracas, besides the seals and the birds and the sea life and the bird life, is we see Nazca lines, which were actually drawings of animals and inscriptions that were carved into the mountains that can be seen from above. And also we see it from our boat as well, you can see. That's called the Nazca lines. And no one's quite sure. Not everyone can understand exactly, and they're not sure how. So there is a little bit of mystery. Some say the Nazca people drew them, and some say it was drawn by the gods. And your local guides will say that to you also, or by aliens. Okay, there are all sorts of interesting theories going around, but in general, it was one of the ways the Nazca people wanted to pass down their culture was by making these inscriptions and drawings into the rocks.
So these drawings are actually a tourist attraction.
They are. Yes, we see them in the regular tour. We see them a little bit in Paracas on our boat tour, but they are all over the country.
Okay, now I have a question. My question is, what time of the year do you usually go? Because from the pictures, you can see that the temperatures are quite, there's a big range of temperatures, right? You've got a range of altitude. But what time of year do you go to Peru?
Okay, so the tours can pretty much go all year round. The tours are generally scheduled for July and November, but also in January and February. As I say, the weather is, and you could go almost any time of the year because the weather is mild. You see,
but presumably it's the same all the year round. It's more or less the same.
I'll tell you the difference. It's very similar to here. In the winter, it can be cooler at night. So you may have to do, you know, in Hebrew they call it shitata batzal. You know, you dress in layers. We can be, you can be wearing short sleeves, you know, in the morning, and you know, when you're walking in Machu Picchu or walking around Lima, and at night you might need your Columbia jacket. But it depends. But we pretty much go all year round. They generally, my tours go July, November, and I've been there also in January and February.
Okay. All right. So those are all the questions. Does anybody else have anything that they would like to say? Speak now or type now.
Oh, they're all unmuted.
Everybody, you're all
we're
all unmuted.
Now.
Would anybody like to say something? Wave your hand. Hello?
Huh? No, I'm okay.
Yeah. Yeah. I would like to say something, Joe.
I just wanted to say thank you. It was absolutely fascinating and really, really amazing. I mean, I didn't know very much about Peru at all beforehand, so I found it really interesting.
Oh, I'm glad. I apologize if it was a bit long. As I said, this was the first time I was doing this type of presentation, and so I think I need to trim it a little bit for the time frame. So I'm sorry it went over the time frame, but thank you for your patience and thank you for listening.
It's fine. It's our pleasure.
I hope you enjoyed it.
Really?
Thank you very much.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
All right, and maybe we'll meet in Peru one day.
HOB to Peru. What do you think, everybody? Yes.
Okay. Corona will end. This virus will end, and we'll be getting on planes again one day.
From your mouth.
Actually, Cindy.
Yes.
Cindy, can I just ask you? Karen Israel. Just wondering, how do you get onto one of your groups? How do you, are you a company?
Okay, so I work generally, I'm a freelancer. I work mainly with a company called Shai Bar Ilan, who there's actually a few ways. There are regular tours that they advertise on their website. Actually, the English-speaking tours are under a company. It's the same company, but they're known as Kesher Kosher Tours. And the Hebrew-speaking tours are Shai Bar Ilan. They have a website you can see and you can sign up for the tours. Okay. Another way is, and I mean, you jokingly said HOP to Peru, but you can get a group together. It could be HOB to Peru. It could be a bunch of friends. It could be family. The Morocco group that Steve and Ellie and Ian and Cheryl joined me on started by a bunch of people from Bet Shemesh who wanted to go to Morocco, and it ended up being a bunch of English speakers from all over the country and some from America as well that got together, and it was sort of like a privately arranged group. So there are different options. You can arrange a group through me. I do the operations through Shai Bar Ilan, but we can arrange a group also. If you have a bunch of people, especially in post-corona, I think that may be the way that some people are going to want to travel. You'd rather be with people that you know, maybe with family members, maybe with people. So that's another option. But I'm not here to do advertising, but if you asked.
Oh, yes.
If Ellie wants to share my details with you guys, afterwards, you're more than welcome to be in touch with me, and I can keep you updated.
Anybody can get the details from me.
Okay. Lovely. What? Thanks very much indeed. Thank you.
Okay.
Anybody else got anything they'd like to say? Yes. No. Yes, Linda. Linda.
How many do you usually have in a group?
It can range. Usually, the smallest group that. Again, it depends, because if it's a private group, it can be a whole different story. But normally the groups can range anything from 12 people to over 30 people. But generally the groups I find are between 15 and 25 people, more or less. But I've had groups that were, I had a group of 38 people and I had a group of 15 people.
Okay, any other questions? Speak now.
Forever hold your peace.
Right. Okay. So I think we're done. Right. So again, right. Thank you very much, Cindy. This was really, really
okay. Thank you for having me.
Yes.
Thank you. All right.
Thank you, Cindy.
Okay. Thank you. Bye, everyone. Good night.
Shabbat shalom.
Shabbat shalom.
Bye. Shabbat shalom.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Shabbat shalom.
Bye. Shabbat shalom.